Welcome to this panel looking at the question of India's role in a wider regional context. The issue of Asia-Pacific or Indo-Pacific is not just a name dispute such as East China Sea, Japan Sea. This is a dispute about how do we conceive of the regional architecture? What is the scope of the area that is really becoming the framework for a new Asian region? My name is Gilbert Rozman, and I have the pleasure of chairing this. Let me briefly introduce our four panelists and then immediately proceed to our substance. On my immediate left is Ambassador Doraiswami. He's the ambassador of India to the Republic of Korea. He was previously the ambassador to Uzbekistan. He spent a number of years in Hong Kong and Beijing and had important posts in New Delhi and at the United Nations, and has a broad sense of the regional issues that we will be discussing. Then we reach Ambassador Paterson from Australia, also the ambassador to the Republic of Korea, but he doubles up with the DPRK and I guess Mongolia. And he was previously ambassador to Thailand, head of the Southeast Asia division in the ministry, and has had other major posts. Again, breadth in looking at these regional themes. Then we move to Daniel Twining from the German Marshall Fund, normally affiliated with the office in Washington, D.C. He served in the policy planning section of the U.S. Department of State and has had other positions in the U.S. government. And finally, Zhu Feng, a Chinese scholar, formerly of Peking University and now of Nanjing University, written a lot on East Asian regional security. Now he's the head of the Center for Collaborative Studies of the South China Sea, long worked on issues of Northeast Asia. So again, a lot of breadth. So with that, we have an opportunity to really get at different conceptions of the regional framework. I'll just ask the overall question about what are we talking about when we discuss regional framework? Is it primarily a security theme? And do we come up with the same regional boundaries and willingness to shift from Asia-Pacific to Indo-Pacific based on geopolitical developments, or are we talking more about the geoeconomic interests and the way the economic ties have been changing as we now are dealing with RCEP and TTP? Or is there also some sense of a community, of a broader framework based on a sense of common values or a common sense of a new Asian identity, which was long missing? I'm looking forward to hearing answers that help us figure out what it is that is central to understanding this region. With that, I'll turn to the ambassador from India.
Thank you very much, Mr. Rozman. Great pleasure to be here again with the Asan folks. Also great to see Ambassador Paterson here again. We've collaborated together on some of these things before. Dan Twining is an old friend from our shared misdeeds on the India-America space. And of course, Mr. Zhu, my long years in China have given me a special interest in China and its policies in the neighborhood. As I tried to put in my initial comments that we were asked to submit a couple of weeks ago, there is history, geopolitical context, and geoeconomic context that supports the idea of a more integrated Australasian community, for want of a better word. We can get into the semantics of whether it should be called an Asia-Pacific community or an Indo-Pacific community, but my understanding is that if you look at the evolution of Asian interests over the last several hundred years, there is a certain commonality that links the Indian Ocean and the Pacific Ocean along its Asian and Australasian contexts in terms of trade, in terms of civilizational impact, and in terms of the evolution of connected spaces between these between the main civilizations of Asia. What does that essentially mean? It essentially means that you have a flow of ideas, of goods, of commodities, and even of security from the East Asian Pacific shores to Southeast Asia and to India, and beyond India into the Middle East, the Gulf states, and the littoral of East Africa. With the arrival of the Europeans into the Asian space, the sea remained a major vector of ideas, but also now of military power. And essentially since then, we have dealt with the larger idea of a connected space between the between Asia's western maritime boundaries and the far boundaries of the Pacific in Asia, the Asia-Pacific maritime boundary, so to speak. So there is a connected space that we see, which, for want of a better word, is really an Indo-Pacific identity, which brings together the countries of this region. I don't know how long we have as an opening comment.
About six or seven minutes. Okay.
Good. Thank you. So I didn't want to be cutting into other people's time. We have, of course, many reasons to look at the Indo-Pacific as a construct. And as Mr. Rozman suggested, you could look at it as a geopolitical construct. But the moment you do that, purely as a geopolitical construct, you run against the question of who is it a geopolitical construct about? And I think that sometimes is a little misleading, because there is an economic context that also integrates the region. To put it in the words of another Australian friend of ours, Rory Metcalf, who had the good sense to serve in India also, Bill, in your embassy in India, Rory Metcalf once described it as a maritime superhighway, which is essentially what the Indian Ocean and the and its adjoining littoral seas are, along with the Pacific space. In today's world, you actually see two-thirds of the world's energy flow through the Indian Ocean region. All the energy supplies, or the majority of energy supplies that Korea and Japan get, and a large chunk of China's energy supplies, comes through this littoral. Similarly, a large chunk of the goods trade that goes through from East Asia westwards goes through the Indian Ocean. Increasingly, as the Australian economy gets strongly integrated into the Asian space, there is a large flow of goods and traffic that sort of takes the Asian maritime superhighway, either through the Indian Ocean or northwards directly into Northeast Asia. All of this suggests that there is a common identity of thought that needs to be put together to create a construct around the Indo-Pacific. I'll leave it at that for my opening comments. I think I've kept within my time.
That's very nice. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ambassador Paterson, please.
Thanks very much, Gil, and thank you to the ASEAN Institute for inviting me to be part of this panel. I guess the concept of an Indo-Pacific region suits Australia's two-ocean geography and our heavy dependence on maritime sea lines of communication and the growth in maritime trade across both oceans. It's got the virtue, of course, of putting Australia at the centre. This is useful for a country which has historically never clearly fitted into a particular group. In the UN, for instance, we still remain in the West European and others group, although clearly, ethnically or otherwise, we don't fit into Western Europe. We're often not considered part of Asia, although I think that's changing, and we're quite different from the small nations of the Pacific. And of course, our population is largely in the Pacific East, and our resources base is predominantly in, or to a great extent, on the Indian Ocean side in the West. Our exports have predominantly traversed the Pacific to the North Asia or the US, but fuels have come from the Middle East, and increasingly we are trading with India. That's grown particularly strongly for Australia. And of course, we're an alliance partner with the United States. We work very closely with the Pacific Command, which of course has a two-ocean footprint. So the concept of Indo-Pacific, which was, I think, first seriously raised earlier this decade, has a certain logic as a framework within which to conceptualize or articulate our national security interests. It reflects changes in our patterns of trade, and it reflects changes in the weight of regional players. It is a region encompassing 60% of the world's population, and for us, of course, in time zones, we're at the center of it. So it's become a bit of a framework in Australia for academics and professionals to describe Asian economic and security dynamics, particularly in relation to China and India. But I think the big question is, does this inform or indeed alter policy? My former colleague and current head of Australia's National Security College, Rory Metcalfe, who Vikram mentioned, he's been a major early proponent of this term, probably because he lived in India for a time. But he argues it's not simply a new term for the Asia-Pacific, but it reflects changes in economic, strategic behaviour and diplomatic institutions that are having real consequences. Well, if that's so, then of course it does matter. Words matter, he argues, and the terminology recasts the mental map of policymakers and others. And the East Asia Summit, he would argue, is an outcome of this changed thinking. But I raise the question, perhaps we can tease this out a bit. Is it too broad a region with too many differences? Vikram talked of an Asia-Pacific community or even an Australasian one. Is it too broad to be meaningful? There are so many differences across this region. Is it a useful way for us in Australia and others to make sense of our strategic neighbourhood? The economic interconnections, I think, are probably pretty obvious, but the strategic ones might be less so. Another Australian professor, Michael Wesley, has argued that the Indo-Pacific is in fact a power highway because it involves massive energy and resource flows as well as merchandise trade. And as China grows, the entry of new powers into the Indian Ocean wielding military muscle. Because these are there are key interests to protect for a number of the players, military muscle is being attracted to secure sea lines of communication and access to growing markets. And there's been a lot of talk about China's interest in establishing a base in Djibouti, where already you have the United States and France there. We've talked in recent years about the String of Pearls, China's construction of the Gwadar base in Pakistan, interest in Sri Lanka, etc. There's also, I think, been a growth in Asian state interest in links to India, which gives the thing substance, to counterbalance, to some extent, China. But of course, I think, I don't know, Vikram will have a view on this. I think part of there's also a measure of Indian suspicion at the return of China to the Indian Ocean. For us, the US military has always had a forward-deployed Indian Ocean presence, matching PACOM's area of responsibility, and I think in Australia we consider this has been entirely positive pretty much since the Second World War. The US forward deployed presence has created the reassurance and stability against which East Asia, including China, grew. So there is this talk amongst academics and others of a coherent strategic system emerging or one that's developed. Perhaps I think questions remain as to whether it adequately explains or encompasses East Asian dynamics as well as those of South Asia. Does it influence or moderate behaviour? Can it be operationalised? Is it simply an academic construct? I don't have the full answers. My government embraces the term. But at the same time, I would argue we have global interests, and we've seen those in recent years in relation to the Middle East, in relation to Ukraine and elsewhere. So I certainly don't think Indo-Pacific would be some construct that entirely shapes and informs Australian behaviour. I'll leave it at that for the moment.
Before we go on, let me ask both of you, as ambassadors stationed here in South Korea, an ally of the United States and a country along with Japan, thinking more broadly about the ties between Northeast Asia and Southeast Asia, whether you are finding increasing efforts to try to draw Southeast Asia and Northeast Asia together strategically. And specifically, Ambassador Paterson, you just mentioned to me the Australian decision about the purchase of the submarines from France rather than from Japan. Is that an issue that, from the Northeast Asian perspective, suggests Australia isn't being drawn so much to Northeast Asia? And Ambassador Doraiswami, there was so much more emphasis on China, the string of pearls and those themes, and the security concerns from the Australian side. Is India more cautious in raising that kind of issue? And are you finding there is an effort here in Northeast Asia to draw India more into this broader security framework and values framework that some see as not favorable to China? So why don't we start with you, Ambassador Paterson?
I'll try and be very brief. I don't see a particular linkage between Southeast Asia and Northeast Asia. For Australia, the stability of the region is critical. Our biggest trading partner is China. Our second largest is Japan, our third largest is the US, and our fourth largest is Korea. So Northeast Asia is absolutely at the heart of our economic well-being, and obviously that informs our strategic outlook too. Places like Korea, we've been here since the Korean War. But Southeast Asia is also critically important because it's our neighbourhood, and we've been involved there bilaterally and through, long time ago, through collective security arrangements like CETO, which has now long time lapsed, but more recently, or more enduringly, the five-power defence arrangements. On the issue of Australia's submarine purchase, that's very much a commercial decision. Australia has an increasingly close defence and security relationship with Japan, and a growing area, I think, of common interest and common concerns about stability in the region. So I'm quite confident that will continue without a beat, really, I think, despite the decision on submarines.
Mm-hmm. On my side, I think, of course, our trade and economic relationships with both Northeast Asia and Southeast Asia are substantive and growing. Of its own, China is our largest trading partner, followed closely thereafter by the US. But Japan and Korea are also major economic partners of India. Southeast Asia, we have also a free trade agreement with Southeast Asia. We have individual free trade agreements, including with ROK, Japan, and with Singapore also. So obviously, India's look east policy and the translation of that into what our Prime Minister today calls an act east policy is very much centered around the idea of doing much more with Southeast Asia and with Northeast Asia, but also with Australia increasingly, including in the commercial space. Turning your question around for a moment, I think if you look at the actions of the major Northeast Asian actors, China, South Korea, and Japan, there is an increasing play into Southeast Asia too. I mean, South Korea on its own accounts for a pretty significant amount of the GDP of Vietnam. I remember reading a figure somewhere around 18% of Vietnam's exports alone come from a couple of South Korean companies. So, you know, you're looking at significant engagement of Northeast Asian countries in the economies of Southeast Asia. If you take that into consideration, it is logical that there would be a certain amount of military muscle that follows the trading flags. This doesn't necessarily mean gunboat diplomacy in the old days, but it does mean that countries looking at their region, their trading interests, and their military and their energy interests would need to find ways of finding security systems to guarantee their trade and energy interests. This is perfectly natural, it's perfectly rational. So to answer your question about string of pearls and so on and so forth, these are things that we read about. We haven't heard anything authoritative from China about whether this is indeed a strategy of the Chinese. So that, of course, would be a very different matter of consideration. But our engagement with China is significant and substantive, and I wanted to answer that directly rather than to go around that. We have a major continental relationship with China, too. It's one of our largest land boundaries. It is the one existing outstanding issue between us in an otherwise cooperative economic and political relationship. So obviously, it is a relationship that matters to both countries. And it's not a relationship that either would casually seek to undermine through minor arrangements here and there. What we see is, to an extent, an extension of China's maritime capacities to follow its trading capacities. It is also logical, therefore, that as India's trade and economic interests with the region, Southeast Asia, Northeast Asia, and indeed the rest of the Indian Ocean littoral increase, you will also see an increase in the presence of Indian maritime assets in the area. So anything that creates a more structured opportunity for countries to talk to each other is a good thing. We have, for instance, recently in February this year, or maybe it was early March, held our first maritime security dialogue with China on a bilateral basis. And the intention of this is to actually start the process of exploration of each other's ideas and thoughts about it, and to address what might otherwise be seen to be feverish notions of what India is doing in the South China Sea, with the countries of Southeast Asia, or what China is doing in the Indian Ocean littoral. It's much better as neighbors and as strategic partners to be able to talk to each other about it. So that's the approach we've taken on these issues, to sort of get out there, engage, and to actually talk through concerns on both sides. And I think it's a helpful exercise, because ultimately the Indian Ocean, the connected seas, that is the South China Sea, and the Pacific Ocean, and all the bays that constitute it, are essentially, ideally, ought to be everybody's free passage. And as long as we all respect that, I think it's a good framework for all of us to be able to work together. Thank you.
Thank you. Dan, are you one of these who subscribes to the notion of Indo-Pacific rather than Asia-Pacific today? We've heard both of our speakers cite Rory Medcalf's work, and he did publish an article in the ASEAN Forum in which he made that case very strongly that we should be talking about Indo-Pacific. But please proceed with your
Thanks.
Comments.
So I don't want to deny Australian victory here, and I'm a Republican, but Hillary Clinton used that term in an official speech about at least 4 years ago when she was Secretary of State. So I think we can debate the provenance. But I mean, the funny thing here from an Indian perspective, so I lived in New Delhi, and every so often I'm asked to present the Indian perspective, which I don't. But just to sort of set the scene for my comments, from an Indian perspective, India's right in the middle of Asia. And so this idea that somehow India is not an integral part of the Asia-Pacific, I think is alien to all of us who look at this region that was really integrated since the end of the Cold War, surely, and the old kind of regional subdivisions imposed by the structural conflict at the international level. Asia is sort of a united whole, and India sits right at the pivot of it.
Thank you, Dan, for saying that. Okay. It would have been hard for me to say it.
Okay. So that's the first sort of baseline. The second baseline is that I think sometimes we come to Northeast Asia, and I think sometimes our Chinese friends are surprised, others are surprised. I mean, India has had naval exercises with Japan and the US in the Western Pacific off of Okinawa, right? India is building this very interesting strategic relationship with Japan. But that doesn't mean that India is some kind of interloper, because it's operating in the Western Pacific or the South China Sea, where India has taken a very clear line in favor of freedom of navigation. China has really its closest alliance relationship, setting aside North Korea, with Pakistan. And China is very heavily engaged in South Asia. The five countries that receive the highest number of Chinese arms exports are all in South Asia. They're all immediate neighbors of India, right? The China-Pakistan Economic Corridor is the centerpiece of the One Belt, One Road initiative thus far, under President Xi. So just as India is looking east and acting east now under President Modi, China's going west, and actually this is quite natural. This isn't strange. Of course, it's a very astute reflection of both countries' interests. Just stepping back a bit, so India is now the world's largest fast-growing economy, the world's fastest-growing large economy, right? It superseded China in that role. India in 2015 was the world's top recipient of foreign direct investment. So I think there's still angst in India and abroad over the slow pace of economic reform in India, just given the very complicated politics of it. But India attracted more FDI than China or the United States last year. And this is quite encouraging. So I guess my thought experiment to you would be to sit back and look at the last 20 years of China's very rapid development. Think about where China was economically and strategically in, say, 1990, 1995, and then think about where it is today. And then do the same experiment with India. Think about what 20 years of growth like China has enjoyed for the past 20 years, project 20 years, and think about what an Indian superpower, budding superpower in 20, 25 years would look like having performed a similar feat. And of course, the strategic consequences of this are very profound. I mean, they're very profound, obviously, developmentally in terms of the welfare of Indians, hundreds of millions of whom are still very, very poor, right? So there are vast domestic welfare implications of this, but there are really important strategic implications for our Asian friends, for our Chinese friends, and for the United States. I mean, the first is the U.S. really sees India as central to this emerging Asian architecture and this emerging Asian balance. India gives Asian countries options they would not otherwise have. The ASEAN countries have been very keen to pull India into closer relationships. Shinzo Abe, Prime Minister of Japan, has said that the India-Japan relationship ultimately will be more important than the U.S.-Japan relationship to the future of the world. So think about that. I mean, it's quite a statement given the intensity of the U.S.-Japan alliance. So you can go around this region and you see a desire for greater Indian leadership and presence and role. You see this in Asian institutions, in the East Asia Summit, and others. So this is quite encouraging. We also think this is really the India-Japan relationship is going to be central to Japan's ability over the long term to sustain itself as one of the leading Asian great powers. Because of course, by itself, Japan is really a small set of islands off of the kind of heartland of Asia. Whereas an alliance with the US and a kind of proto-alliance with India, which also has a very big economic dimension in terms of their own economic synergies, creates a very different kind of triangle of interests in Asia. And of course, our Chinese friends, I think it would be unhealthy for them, even from a Chinese perspective, to dominate Asia, right? Hegemony leads to all sorts of temptations. Unipolarity can be actually quite destabilizing. But we look out and we see a strong, dynamic, rising India that's anchoring an Asian balance of power, and not just a balance of power, but a balance of ideas. An India that is a great democracy that demonstrates that the Chinese model of kind of dictatorial capitalism, if you will, is not the only model. That kind of this state-led authoritarian model of investment that has produced such extremely impressive returns in China, though at a very high cost, is not the only way for developing countries to grow and to uplift their people out of poverty. So we look at India's future, not in kind of raw balancing terms, but we see it actually in terms of our own ideals and the kind of Asia and the kind of world we would like to see really take root in the 21st century, which is one in which a pluralism of ideas and politics and power in Asia and more broadly is at play and at large. And that's a very different future for Asia, including for all the countries that will be positively influenced by India's example, than is an Asia in which China is dominant, right? In which this region becomes a kind of an informal hierarchy, which I think would be very unhealthy, not just for many Asian countries, but also for China. So I'll wrap up just by saying that in many ways, India is the swing state in this region. I mean, we know the US alliance system, I think, will remain and endure and deepen as it's been deepening in recent years. China has its own network, which overlaps, obviously, with that of the US and its allies in this region. And India is this great variable. And we see an India that becomes more confident as it grows more powerful and that swings in the direction of sustaining an open and liberal order in this region. And I'll close with the thought that actually in the India-China relationship, I mean, these countries can manage their own relations. We're not in the middle of it, and we're not even in Asia. And these countries have been managing their relations for far longer than we've been engaged here. But as an American, I would posit to you that the US, in a way, is the swing state between China and India. Because on the one hand, India is in a very different position if there's some kind of US-China G2 that develops. that diminishes the role of other powers in Asia. Conversely, relations with China look very different if the US and India have what Prime Minister Modi has actually talked about as an alliance. We used to not be able to say this in an Indian context, but Prime Minister Modi now says it, that all things are possible in US-India relations, even a kind of an alliance-like relationship. So there's a lot at play in this very interesting triangle, and I would say, of course, our Japanese friends, our Korean friends, our European friends will also be part of this. So it's not simply a strategic triangle. But I think, again, closing up, as someone who lived in India, I think India's rise is really one of the most optimistic things we could discuss in a day that's otherwise been characterized by a bit of doom and gloom. Thank you.
Thank you. Quick question, follow-up, because I think your comment about Japan, India is particularly intriguing, and you've written on this. What would you say makes the Japan-India relationship special, as opposed to Japan, India, U.S., and Japan just carrying forward the overall U.S. interest and India interest in improving that this great power linkage? Is there some kind of demographic complementarity? Are the Japanese going to invite Indians to migrate? Is there something about Abe's sense of Asian values that's going to link the two? What is the optimism about this relationship?
So, I mean, this is very interesting given all of the history issues in this region, because there's a lot of history between India and the U.S., right? We've produced arms embargoes on India. We had a very tetchy relationship during the Cold War. We armed Pakistan. India and Japan, it's very interesting because India was the one Asian country that, of course, was not subject to Japanese imperialism during the Pacific War and the run-up to it. And so the countries essentially start without a lot of baggage. The complementarities are really exciting, actually. I mean, you mentioned the demographics. India is soon going to have the world's biggest population. It really will have the world's biggest workforce. Looking out, the demographic projections are very interesting. I mean, India is going to have a workforce that's hundreds of millions bigger than China's, given China's already peaked demographically. Its workforce is shrinking as a percentage of the population. India's workforce is going to keep rising for the next 20 years. And so you look at Japanese deep, deep reserves of capital, of technology, of search abroad for investment destinations. You look at India's great deep capacity on human capital, on infrastructure requirements, in services, in health and education, and all these areas where the kind of building a modern Indian welfare state would benefit so much from both capital and technology and know-how. And you see these two countries in a way fit together like yin and yang.
Now, does South Korea fit in with India in similar ways? There's a demographic parallel.
I mean, it's interesting. I mean, Vikram can speak to this quite authoritatively, but when I lived in India 10 years ago, what was really interesting was the South Korean companies were far ahead of the Japanese ones in terms of their know-how and their active investments and production in India, whereas Japanese were still scratching their heads trying to navigate India's laws and bureaucracies.
We'll come back to that in a little while. Zhufeng, I'd like to hear your views on this as someone who's not part of the usual range of countries that are drawing India more into Southeast Asia. And now that you've spent time as the director of an institute working on the Indian Ocean and the South China Sea, how are your thoughts evolving?
Okay, so first of all, I have to say India, for most of Chinese, remain a foreign concept. But the problem is if we look at our historical bonds and the cultural interactions in some sort of historical term, we are a very close neighbor, and we are also culturally, economically reciprocating, not just for the time being, but for the past 2,000 years. At the beginning, we say the reconceptualization of India Ocean is definitely targeted at China for some sort of a geopolitical consideration. But now, if we're still resting on such an assumption, it will be extremely narrow. I think there's a very interesting metaphor to describe the geopolitics in Asia Pacific. It's called China-US is the two elephants. If they're fighting, then grasses suffer. If they're making love, then grasses suffer either. So if we can pulling like India together, three elephants, they're just charting, dancing, and always just discussing. So I hope
India's enter into the Asian Pacific is not just a rhetoric. It's not just some sort of, we say, strategic design or policy debate. We need some sort of real roadmap. So from the Chinese perspective, we would like to open our arms, welcoming India's sitting and coming in the Asia Pacific for two reasons, very basically. One is economically. Then we will see the India's economic engagement to the, Southeast Asia and Northeast Asia is also surging so rapidly. So China-India's relationship, even in the value of trading value, it's also very promisingly will be leading some sort of future China's restructure of the international commercial relations. So we also see the flowing of the Chinese capitals into India also increasing very, very promptly. So then on the other hand, we also see, for example, geostrategically, 15 years ago, there's a lot of speculation in air and just the foretelling some sort of dragon and elephant fighting. I think 15 years ago, I say it is really, really mistaken illusion. So 15 years later, then we will see, yes, China, India, not just how they could get along well with each other, then we can complement each other. Of course, we match each other, but most important thing is we can benefit each other. So most important question for us to answer is not how feasible or desirable for us to welcome India sitting in the Asian Pacific. Most important thing is politically and technically, how we can pull in India's hands and less than sitting with us. For example, APEC will be welcome to India. Then the EAS also could just leave the room from India. AIF, all such as settings, will also need to not just create a room for India to maneuver. Most important things, what kind of India's contribution, India's, you know, some sort of their unique, you know, the source could be fully just reflected. That's a key question. Last one I would like to say is, yes, there's some sort of speculations about China's strategic intention. Dan is very, very knowledgeable to Asia and mentioned a couple of times China's future probably is some sort of China's dominance. But I have to say, if China will be possible to dominate Asia, it must be happening under the ceiling of the US-led, US-centric alliance system. That kind of Asian dominance will happen? No. I think China's future will be some sort of proactive and important member of Indo-Pacific. So we hope it's not just a big, some sort of framework to accommodate the different country. Most important thing is it should be community. As the we discussed a lot. So community is not a European experience, but also now is the way to neutralize the power competition. So India's enter with India's very unique contribution based on its rich culture and also very admirable tradition, I think China will feel unbelievable comfortable. Most important thing is, what will happen to American superiority? Or what will happen to American, you know, regional preeminence? So from this point, if India's coming also will lead to some sort of growing diversity in a regional security framework, why not China should just inspire for that kind of the scenario? I'm very honest. So futures Asian Pacific or Indo-Pacific will not be just overwhelmingly staged some sort of power struggle episode just between China and the United States. China is a newly emerging player in the region. But if there's a lot of proactive and a very thoughtful place also coming and joining us, most important things, it will lead into the regional growing, we say, pluralism, or it will be a big, you know, enhancement to the Americans' preeminence. I'm very questioning about this. So then, when we talk about the desirability of India, Pacific concept. Most important thing is not China's readiness. It should be some sort of a new push on how some such a regional framework could evolve based on some sort of a mutual respect, not just between China and US, also to the all leading players in the region.
The issue of China's relationship to Pakistan came up, and as suggested, that is the central piece of the One Belt, One Road phenomenon. How would you place India in the context of One Belt, One Road?
Okay.
Is India seen now as a problem to getting the regionalism through RCEP? Because India, some say, is dragging its feet on some of the higher standards of trade, and China, if China is pushing for RCEP, is it having problems with India being involved there? So this gets at the question of whether China-India relations really are as promising as some have suggested. Go ahead.
Yep, I think the China-India relations, of course, historically, once traumatized, then we also see some sort of such a legacy remain not completely curable. So India, at least, also still got stuck of some sort of China anxiety. That's totally understandable. But the problem is the Chinese well repeated in 1962's mistake. We launched the border wars, just racing for some sort of such a non-inhabited areas. Yes, back to 1960, that kind of China is a very revolutionary China. That kind of a Beijing, who just how say, was busy with the exporting the revolution. But never forget, in the past 2,000 years, there was only one single time Chinese and India exchanged the file. So then I'm very confident about the future's prospect between New Delhi and China, because there's no historical analogies, there's no historical burden, there's no historical problem at all to get the Chinese and the Indians fall apart. Pakistan issue has been modified and mitigated for long. I don't think that Beijing now just has a bet on Pakistan to counterbalance the India. The China's policy, even 15 years ago, when Liu Zhongji became the Chinese prime minister, and he made the way to New Delhi and very strongly and vocally declared, we will take the Islamabad and New Delhi at the same level, at the same some sort of, we say, strategically important position. That means the Beijing recognized we should back off from some sort of a traditional geographical entanglement, then just moving on the new era of our relations with the both. Today, what does the Pakistan mean for China? It's a strategic asset for Beijing to rebalance India? Or it's some sort of traditional friendship driven, some sort of, we say, good neighborhood? I prefer the later to the former. So then Islamabad also complained a lot. For example, Beijing's assistance flowing to the Pakistan, also just the dropping, because China now is very realistic. If we invading in Pakistan, we hope such an investment will be profitable. So this kind of the new scenario, I think it will be very, very foretelling of future relations between China, India, and Islamabad, and Pakistan. So as for the One Belt, One Road, notably, India's response will be a leading variable on how such an idea could come true. So far, I see India still very hesitant. I don't want to open the arm to the One Belt, One Road initiative. But if personally, I'm also very skeptical to the future of the One Belt, One Road, because I don't think it's a well-planned, also reality relevant. Probably it's just some sort of political call on China's, such a big infrastructure capability driven commercial plane. So personally, I'm very cautious about the real prospect of one belt, one road initiative. So I don't think the India's hesitation will be truly blocking China from moving forward with one belt, one road. So most important for the time being is how India and Beijing we can fit in better with each other, and also could help building some sort of such a better off based our economic and strategic and political relationship.
Thank you. Before we go to the audience, I wonder if Ambassador Doraiswami wants to respond to any of the comments made.
Difficult to respond to some of those. No, but I think first of all, beginning with what Professor Chu said, I think I agree with him. I think we certainly in government don't have a perspective of China that is solely informed by one episode in our long history. I think Premier Wanjaba put it very well when he talked about 99.9% of our long history together has been an actually a very pleasant and cooperative one, in which ideas, goods, and even mutual cultural influences have gone across the Himalayas. So obviously that's not the perspective. Of course, there has been previous concerns, which I think Professor Zhu addressed rather directly, about the older China-India relationship and the China-South Asia relationship. But fundamentally, the principle today that we look at that we have in looking at China, is that this is a relationship in which we have complementarities and some areas of competition. And the competitive areas are fundamentally economic rather than anything else. But broadly, we fully understand, accept, and welcome the fact that China has arrived as a major economic weight in the global system. The fact that India has opened out huge sectors of its economy to Chinese investment and trade suggests that this is not a relationship that is looked at in a particularly jaundiced manner. We would like Chinese investment to come in. We would like more trade with China, more economic involvement, because that is also a cementing factor in the relationship. To give you an example of how quick this is, many of you may not get the point that I'm making otherwise. When I served in China, giving you a personal example, I left China in the year 2000. At that point of time, our trade had increased in 10 years from $200 million to $2 billion with a B. Since from 2000 to 2008, trade went up to $40 billion. And from 2008 to today, it is at nearly $85 billion. So we are talking about a relationship that has been transformed in many senses by the rise of China, and we believe that the economic rise of India will similarly help transform our relationship to a further more productive balance. The point that Dan made, if I may, I think the contestation is not really one that is sought by any government. We're not looking at a contest of ideas. Our system works for us. Indeed, there are those of you who've been to India who might wonder whether there is any system that works in India. But democracy is probably the least worst system that works in India. And whatever system works for us, we're not seeking to export it as a model. It works for us because this is our reality. The system that works for China, it has obviously worked remarkably well for China. And it is for China and the Chinese people to figure out how best the system will evolve further on down the road. As to how the other countries of the region look, Southeast Asian and Northeast Asian region look at it, look, I think Dan is absolutely right when he talks about the Japan-India relationship, because that has been an important part of our consistent approach. Looking at Japan fundamentally from the start as an important partner in facilitating India's economic development. That has been the most important piece. And it has, of course, been ironic that it was Korean companies that got there first in the 1990s. It is a little known fact, in fact, that Hyundai Motors actually opened its first two manufacturing lines in India before it opened them in China even. So, you know, the fact that Korean companies are household successes in India testifies to their adventurousness and their entrepreneurship in the 90s. Perhaps a little less so in the last few years, but maybe this is something that needs to change. I don't see this as being in any sense directed at China, for instance, or at anybody else. This is fundamentally because Japan, Korea, China itself can play an important role in facilitating the massive doses of investment that we need of technology, capital, and indeed manufacturing depth to get hundreds of millions out of conditions of poverty that they're in. So that is an important part of the piece. Southeast Asia, historically, our approach to Southeast Asia is based on strong cultural ties. And revisiting those ties, whether it's the northern part of Southeast Asia, the CLMV countries, or the oceanic countries of Southeast Asia, Indonesia, Malaysia, Singapore, Papua New Guinea, and Brunei, and Philippines, these are varying parts of the pieces. And as you'll see, there is a difference in the way India's approached each of these countries based on the extent of its connectivity. So this is more a sense of looking at these countries rather than as a block, but as individual parts of a piece that work for India. I think I've covered all the points.
Thank you, you have. Let's turn to questions from the audience, and if others want to respond to anything said by other panelists, they can do so after. Dimitri, please, wait for a mic.
Thank you very much for the very interesting panel. I have two questions. First goes to the Indian panelist, and the second to all the panelists. I think the question Asia-Pacific or Indo-Pacific is absolutely fair, absolutely justifiable. But we could, I think, at least theoretically and hypothetically, add another angle to that, which is Indo-Asian. Meaning deepening of Indian integration and participation in the Asian and Eurasian context, but without the United States. I'm not asserting that this is what happening right now, but I think we should keep it at least as a hypothetical and theoretical option on the table. And indeed, I mean, India is a participant in RCEP negotiations. India has just joined the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, but India does not participate in TPP. So my first question to you, what is the Indian stance on TPP? Are you going to join, when, on which terms, and so on and so forth? What's your position on the Trans-Pacific Partnership? And the second more general question to the panel as a whole, what's your take on the interplay between the TPP and RCEP? How do you see the future of those two groups evolving? Will they simply coexist? Will they be rivals? Will they merge eventually? Maybe the Australian ambassador could speculate on that, since you participate in both, right? The rest of the representatives of the panel don't. So how do you see the future of the interplay between these two regimes, I would say. Thank you.
Thank you. Let's take a few more questions if we have them, and then come back to the audience. Way back there.
Thank you. I haven't heard the word Russia.
Introduce yourself.
Donald, my name is Don Kirk. I'm a journalist. I haven't heard the word Russia mentioned by this panel. Maybe I missed it. But India, of course, receives great arms aid from Russia. Which has a lot to do with historically balancing against the U.S. and also against China. I wonder if the Indian ambassador could comment on Russia's relationship with India vis-a-vis the U.S. and China. There are many more questions would stem from that, but that's my basic question, since it seems strange to me that Russia hasn't come up as a topic during this discussion. Thank you.
Thank you. Question back there.
Thank you, Leif Easley, Yihua Women's University and the Asan Institute. I appreciate the comments of all the panelists, and I just wish there was one more chair for a Japanese participant, because it seems to me that the Japanese relationship with India is a critical piece of this discussion. And I would like to ask the panelists, I think I know what Dan thinks, but really any of the panelists to respond to the sustainability of this budding strategic cooperation between India and Japan. Do you see it as continuing past these very particular leaders that are now at the helm of the respective countries, or post Abe, post Modi, would it be a strategic relationship that has that same enthusiasm? And in particular, what if there's a significant change in either India or Japan's relationships with China? Would we still see the motivation behind the Japan-India partnership? Thank you.
Thank you. Right over here, another question.
Steve Kargman. My question is, to what extent do the panelists see the potential for maritime competition or even confrontation at some point in the Indian Ocean?
Okay, and
here. I'm Chen Yang-woo, a senior advisor to the Asan Institute. I'm very much intrigued by David Twining's Daniel Twining's swing state theory and triangular relationship among India, Japan, China. And I think there is good reason for Japan and India to be drawn to each other closely. Apart from what you mentioned, I think they are allies in their aspirations for permanent membership in the Security Council also. So this is a strong political bond apart from geopolitics of the Indo-Pacific. Well, I think East Asian security is inseparable from security of India in that in the sense that to the extent that Chinese resources are consumed by geopolitical competition with India, pressure on East Asia could ease. So I see very important connection between East Asia and India in that regard. And the question I would like to put to Ambassador Doraiswami of India is, how India sees China's One Belt, One Road initiative, AIIB? What kind of geopolitical perspectives do you have? Do you think this is just more than geoeconomics, more of geopolitics, with strategic competition with India in mind?
Thank you. Well, let's stop there and go to our panelists one by one. Ambassador.
Let me start with Dimitri's questions. Excellent questions, thank you. You asked about, you spoke about the Indo-Asian idea. Actually, if you, you know, we were asked to submit talking points within which we would speak, so I didn't want to speak to those. But if you see what I'd written, I had specifically pointed to the existence of two, not contending, but broadly parallel ideas of Asia. One is the idea of a maritime Asia, which is where you see developmental impulses flowing from East Asia, eastwards towards India now, and hopefully further on, Sri Lanka, Pakistan, Afghanistan, and beyond into the Middle East. And the other being continental Asia. So I'm not necessarily getting into the Mahan versus Mackinder debate here, but there is a relevance to the larger idea of a Eurasian context. The way we look at it, if you look at where we sit in India, to our western borders, if you're sitting in Delhi and you're looking north, to our western borders, we have the world's biggest sources of energy, but also currently a lot of instability is co-located with these world's sources of energy. Further north, you have the Central Asian countries, all of which have strong historic and cultural ties with India, and of course Russia beyond that, which, by the way, I did mention Russia in my initial speaking notes. The point is, all of this has to eventually form part of a larger theoretical and geopolitical construct if you are to deal with Asian security. Beyond security, there is also an economic piece. China has already shown us that. From the early 1990s, when after the dissolution of the Soviet Union, China was one of the fastest players to move into the natural resources and the energy and the trade piece in Central Asia. You only have to look at the extent to which transportation networks have been built, the extent to which oil pipelines have been built, to recognize how quickly China understood the importance of its own Central Asian backyard and the Eurasian continent, quite apart from its massive developmental thrust that was coming out of its eastern seaboard. So, you know, kudos to China for getting that right. The rest of us in Asia, particularly countries like India, which are, like China, both maritime and continental countries, are still struggling with our sometimes perverse tendency of cutting off our nose to spite our faces, which is essentially to say that we could have had and should have had capacity to trade through Pakistan and Afghanistan with Central Asia. This is logical. This is what history has always had. We have not been able to do it, and that is more for a public forum like this, more a collective fault of South Asia rather than anything else. But this will work. As sanctions on Iran are lifted, the port at Chabahar, the port at Bandar Abbas are going to be important parts of the peace. India is part of the North-South Corridor project with Russia and Iran. India is building a port at Chabahar. The intention of all of this is to continue to be able to access and supply goods and services into Afghanistan, but beyond, into Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan, and the entire Central Asian landmass. So absolutely, I agree with you. This is entirely part of it. How we integrate this concept with the idea of an Indo-Pacific is probably something that will need two steps of action to be taken. It's already complicated enough to try and look at an Indo-Pacific peace, which brings together the Pacific and the Indian Oceans. It's probably going to be require a certain amount of integration to try and think through how we will work out the mechanics of a Central Asian, Eurasian, Asian peace. Largely because you're talking about three now very distinct areas with very different geoeconomic and geopolitical problems that happen there. RCEP, as things stand, and I know you did refer to this question also, Mr. Rozman, about India and the RCEP. We certainly are interested in a mega trade deal. And for us, the fact that China, South Korea, Australia, all our major trade partners will be part of this, ASEAN, is certainly a USP. We would certainly like this to succeed. The TPP as it currently stands, and as it has currently been signed, presents genuine challenges to us. More than anything else, I think the idea of a WTO plus or WIPO plus arrangements on intellectual property is a serious problem. We are committed and we have faithfully abided by our commitments on WIPO. However, going beyond the World Intellectual Property Organization standards on TRIPS plus arrangements would be a problem for India. I don't know how China sees it, and I certainly wouldn't venture to speak for China on this subject. But the idea of stepping beyond already agreed multilateral conventions is challenging. If you look at the way the world is being divided up into competing trading blocks, this is something we all need to step back and think again about. Because I do wonder, speaking personally at this moment, what happens to the trade mechanism that we were trying to create with earlier rounds of GATT, now the WTO, the Doha round has been stalled. But if you're not going to be able to work together multilaterally, then dividing the world up into competing pieces is certainly not the best recipe that anyone in Asia or anywhere else can see, certainly not in India's interest. Sorry, I've answered somebody else's question also, but I presume that was addressed to all of us. Mr. Kirk asked a question. May I take them all then, the ones that were addressed to me, or do you want me to leave it for a moment at that?
Why don't we go through the others and then come back to you? You'll answer them eventually, sure. Yes. Ambassador Paterson.
Well, thanks, Gil. I'm only going to address a couple of points directly relevant, I think, to me. Mr. Susilov asked about interplay between the TPP and RCEP. Could they merge? I'm not an expert on trade policy, but simply to say from our perspective, we would like to see a situation where they could merge, I think. We would like to see an arrangement which encompassed China and indeed India, but fundamentally we don't see this in strategic terms, we see it in economic terms. We see both countries needing to meet certain benchmarks, economic benchmarks, to get in. If those are achieved, then I think we would welcome them in. There's been talk in the US, of course, as TTP as being central, being strategic in a sense, central to the US rebalance to Asia. For Australia, that's not the case. We see it purely in economic terms, I think. Of course, it's helpful, perhaps, but it's just that the big markets are there. We need them. We have a series of free trade agreements now with Japan, China, Korea. We're negotiating one with India. We're in fairly good shape in that sense, but we worry about this proliferation of agreements and the difficulty in managing that, trying to interest Australian business in reading 1,000-page FTAs is really very, very difficult. So we would prefer a simplified system encompassing more of our trading partners and potential trading partners. The only other thing I wanted to comment on was the question about Japan's relation with India. Is this sustainable? We've got to start, I think, thinking of Japan very much as a normal country. And I think Prime Minister Abe has taken Japan well down that road. It's a big country, it's a big economy. It has strategic and economic interests. It would be normal for it to have a role in the Indian Ocean as well as the Asia Pacific. It's got the capacity, I think, to play a very helpful stabilising and security role in certain circumstances. My main worry with Japan, I think it's going the right direction, but I wonder whether demography is going to be a limiting factor. As Japan turns inward with an ageing population, whether it will want to sustain that more extensive international role. I hope it does, but I worry whether it'll have the capacity to do so.
Thank you. Dan?
So the US and India have a really great relationship, except when it comes to trade. So you've scratched my itch, and I'm only going to do this for a minute. But I must say, as an American, it's rather rich to hear from an Indian good friend that US regional deals undermine global multilateralism and trade. And you can, Vikram, we can go back and forth on this. But what we remember from 2008 when I was in government and the WTO Doha round blew up conclusively and definitively was the Indian then Commerce Minister Kamal Nath standing up and saying, I'm not going to sacrifice the welfare of hundreds of millions of Indian farmers on the altar of global trade, and then walked out. And that was the end of the Doha round. And so you can ask successive US trade negotiators from both political parties, the reason we have reverted to things like TPP and TTIP is because we could not get the WTO Doha round completed. And that was not India's, I mean, there are many factors at play. These are very complex negotiations. But the US does not see regional agreements as preferable to, I mean, I think we agree wholeheartedly that global trade liberalization is the most effective and efficient. India, last thing I'll say on trade is I actually worry about India's prospects because India is not in TPP, it's obviously not in TTIP, it's not in APEC, and if these big mega regional deals move through TPP and TTIP, India is going to be left in this strange middle ground where it's actually going to be essentially discriminated against because of these mega regional deals. And RCEP, I'm afraid, will not solve the problem. China is very interesting in joining TPP, which we're quite encouraged by. And I think once upon a time, we thought the way to do that was to basically fuse RCEP and TPP, as I think Gil suggested. But we now look at RCEP's trade standards as potentially being so low that fusing these agreements will not work. And the much more straightforward thing to do would be for China to join TPP, which your officials and think tankers are actually talking about quite actively, but India is not there for obvious reasons yet. Just two other things very quickly on the UN Security Council question. I don't know if this is true for Japan, I believe it is, but I know it's true for India. Every permanent member of the UN Security Council has committed to support India's membership in the UNSC except one, which is China. And I believe the same is true for Japan. So I think from our Chinese friends' perspective, being the only Asian country there is something they don't want to give up too easily. On maritime competition in the Indian Ocean, I think people have been surprised by what a robust stance India has taken on the South China Sea. And that predates Prime Minister Modi. Manmohan Singh also made some very forward-leaning statements on freedom of navigation in the South China Sea. Part of this is India's traditional look east policy. India does not want its main trade and economic corridors to Northeast Asia closed or put in question by any kind of Chinese, even de facto, control over the South China Sea. But part of this, I think, from an Indian grand strategic perspective, is if China did basically succeed in staking out the position it looks like it's attempting to stake out in the South China Sea, that puts the Chinese Navy and really the world's largest attack submarine force, right at the gateway to the Indian Ocean. And so if you're sitting in India looking at your interests in sustaining these aid and energy corridors, trade corridors, looking at your friends in the Indian Ocean who you don't want to have become Chinese naval bases, you get quite anxious when you think about the power projection capabilities right out of the Straits of Malacca that are made possible by a very heavy Chinese footprint in the South China Sea. So I just wanted to make that direction, that connection.
Thank you.
I think a couple of questions I'd like to very briefly respond in. First of all, TPP and RECP or something like that. I don't think there will be some sort of inherent competition because, first of all, TPP now is ratified by the province. When it will be put into the effects, it's a bigger test for China. Then on the other hand, when we talk about the interactions or interconnections between the geopolitics and the geoeconomy, it's also very, very, I think, amazing, of course, a pressing matter of fact for all regional players to approach. So then TPP, of course, is the leading economic pillar of the rebalancing strategy, but from the Chinese perspective, nothing could risk keeping the regional economic prosperity. That should be top of all the agendas of our players. So then China will be open to TPP and RECP, whatever it is. Then second is, I think critical piece of the Japan, I think it's a very interesting question. But it seemed to me one of the leading motives behind the Abe administration to keep India within the arm is a very high profile pronouncement of the value diplomacy. Of course, we consider it will not survive for long because the region will like to fall into some sort of a strategic split around the ideological line. China is a transformative power. Who knows what will befall into my country with what kind of political colors. So don't just say permanently and notably characterize China as some sort of alien. That would be unbelievably stupid. So from this point, I think the China-India relations is really, really a robust because we are different, but we complement each other in a very, very reciprocal way. On the other hand, we will see Russia-India relations. It's a very interesting history. For Chinese, that kind of like India is really, really, to be honest, get a Chinese easy reason. Because if we know like India's history of the diplomacy, India is very proud, independent, and a highly contributive power, not just in the region, but also in the world. That kind of India deserves the Chinese full embracement. I'm very convinced of that. Then another one is potential maritime conflict in the Indian Ocean. I have to say it's a delusion. Whatever how big China's navy will be, how can China just stay safely and comfortably in the China's neighboring water areas remain unanswered question. If China just trying to expand some sort of first state in South China Sea, what kind of a ban we are making? It's a big lesson for Chinese. If the Chinese submarine fleets getting through, the Malacca Strait and frequently and routinely just working on the present, at the present to the Indian Ocean, what does it mean for Chinese? What kind of a power projection we would like to pursue? China has never been more divided. Someone say, look at today's China, or commercially we go global. So we need also global maritime navy capability. But I have to tell you, Mahan theory is a Mahan trap for Chinese. We will not be that stupid. As for China's ground strategy, the best way to keep China's overseas interests is continuously to be a free rider. All the Western powers would like to see China to be a free rider. Middle East now is very chaotic. There's a lot of a debate for Chinese on what way we can engage the Middle East. Someone say, yes, we should cross the line and stepping on the Middle East. But the Chinese way to the Middle East inevitably and ultimately surely in the ocean. It will cause the stir. It will fuel the competition. So the best way for China to look at the Middle East is it's a European obligation. It's Americans' commitment. We prefer to sit idle. So then, never believe China's maritime power will be skipped over the Malacca Strait into the Indian Ocean, because I see no necessity at all. So then, I hope my India friends also could take the easy breeze, and our American friend also could see the same way. Last question is, I find it's also very interesting, for example, so we also see, for example, South China Sea tension, and what kind of India's role from the Chinese perspective we expect. I have to say we got a very, very severe lesson from current South China Sea tension. Sooner or later, I will see the tension will be head off. So then India now is looking east and acting east. I think it will be a very good help for China to ease down. So then I really appreciate Mr. Ambassador's words. If China is both continental power, maritime power, we're just trying to a little bit stretch out in the maritime areas. But now we hit a lot of the snap. We got it into the mind. Thanks.
Thank you. We have just a certain number of minutes, maybe 5 minutes left, and I want Ambassador Doraiswami to speak. You have some other comments, and I think you can respond to the variety of comments on the panel as well, please.
Thank you. I'll try and be as brief as possible. There were a few other questions directed to me, so I don't intend to hog the floor. About the Russia-India relationship, there were two sort of questions around that. Absolutely, I think I've tried to talk to some of that. Russia has been and remains an important strategic partner of India. I think the exact shade of word we use is that it's a special privileged partnership. And the idea is that Russia continues to play an important role as it has re-entered the Asian arena with a role in the East Asia summit process. I think our Chinese colleague put it well when he said that India has looked at the world largely through an independent lens. And the relationship with Russia is part of that independent lens. We're proud of our relationship with the United States. It's been an important transition moment in the last 15 years, and I've been fortunate to work in some of that, to see how it has changed from the scratchiness that surrounded everything else. It continues on trade, and I'll come to that in a moment. But on everything else, the relationship has transformed beyond belief. We believe, as a country of India's size, we cannot necessarily be placed in anyone's one sort of pocket. It's logical that we would have important and consequential global relations with the United States, with China, with Japan, as well as with Russia. And we don't see a contradiction in working on these issues. On the question of the Japan-India relationship and the sustainability of it, I think Dan put it well. I think this is something that has actually preceded these leaders, actually. If I look at my own personal experience, I've seen the Modi government reach out to Mr. Vajpayee in a period when, to put it mildly, India wasn't exactly the flavor of the day. I've seen the Vajpayee government reach out very strongly thereafter to Prime Minister, to the next Japanese Prime Minister who was in power. I've seen thereafter significant efforts in the Manmohan Singh government and also now in the Modi government. So essentially, the Japan-India piece, we see it as being something that goes beyond administrations in either country, in particular in India. I can't speak, of course, for the Japanese government. Just as we see the India-US relationship as something that has nicely transitioned beyond being a partisan issue to being something of equal importance to all political parties, whether it's in the United States or in India. On the subject of whether this is consequential to China, I don't think this is necessarily the case. As I've tried to suggest, the relationship with Japan has continued to grow irrespective of whether Japan's relations with China have been good or bad, and whether India's relationship with China has gone through a peak or a trough. So irrespective of that, there is a role for the Japan relationship as far as India sees it. Maritime competition, I think an important point was made by all of the panelists. Competition happens when you don't necessarily have the systems in place to handle it. And I think our American colleagues in their conversations with China are making some very interesting points about good practices for navies to follow. As our Chinese colleague mentioned, China has now built a large naval capacity with blue water elements in it. It is logical that you will see Chinese vessels out and further afield. In that case, it makes sense for all maritime players in the Indian Ocean and the Pacific Ocean to improve coordination, signaling, and capacity to work with each other. I think the US has played an important role, for instance, in some of its activities. Name has slipped my mind for the moment. The naval exercise that you do every year in June, every biennially in June, that's an important opportunity for the world, RIMPAC exercises, for global navies. Russia is present in that. India has started attending it. China was present at the last one. I think all of this has good value for everybody to learn best practices in deconflicting maritime space. Right now, I think the Indian Ocean space requires the presence of more navies to actually deal with things like instability flowing off countries like Somalia or Yemen. So the role of ROK Navy vessels there, Japanese vessels, obviously the United States, Australia, India, China, has a function in ensuring everybody's interests are served, because after all, this is one of the world's most important energy waterways. Lastly, sir, your question about India seeing OBOR, AIIB, and these structures. The AIIB, as you already know, we are the second largest contributor to the AIIB. So we have fully embraced the concept of new financial architecture to deal with Asia's need for infrastructure. We see very strongly that we are one of the Asian countries that needs infrastructure. So we would be silly not to take advantage of an opportunity that our Chinese friends are bringing on board. Similarly, we are part of the New Development Bank Initiative, which is a BRICS initiative, which brings Russia, China, India, Brazil, and South Africa to the board. Again, there we have a significant financial contribution to make to that. On OBOR, as our Chinese colleague suggested, there are issues about it that still need to be fleshed out. And I think at this particular time, it would probably be prudent for India to sit back and wait until this whole concept is fleshed out a little further before we actually commit ourselves to taking a position on this one. Finally, on the question of values diplomacy, that of course is a matter relevant to Japan. But on the UN Security Council piece, and I can't resist making this particular point, I think it's important for this process to actually move on to a more substantive discussion in the United Nations. We keep going around and around the subject because the United Nations quite often resembles what Yes Minister described as government, which is it has the engines of a lawnmower, but the brakes of a Rolls Royce. So it tends to stop far more easily than it goes anywhere, which of course is a lot like international trade. And we can of course decide who takes the blame for which bit of what particular trade negotiation blew up. But since Dan is a good friend and I've already exceeded my time, I think we'll not get down to the levels of pointing fingers at each other on this one. Thank you very much.
Perfect time. We ended just on time. Please join me in thanking our panelists.